attacked by 100 turtle-sized sharks or a shark-sized turtle?
Now, I've always imagined that probably the best way to die would to be chased and eaten by a lion. Okay, this is one of my kind of death fantasies, and there are more than one, which is a bit odd, isn't it, really? But the turtle-sized sharks, no, because that would be like a ning, 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 ning. And a shark-sized turtle would be like a chomp. And I'm more into a chomp.
Yeah, one big bite.
One big chomp, and you're gone. Yep.
Where were you born?
I was born in Gwent. Yeah, Newport Gwent Hospital.
And did you have a mountain outside your house?
We did. You never saw the light of day in Risca because, come spring, summer, autumn, winter, there's a mountain in front of the house, and we never saw any daylight. Hence my love of the sunshine now. Whenever I can see, there's a parting in the clouds, get out in it! Because it wasn't something that was very common in my upbringing.
Brilliant. In the last 20 years, how many different hairstyles would you think you've achieved?
Well, not as many as Ron.
I was going to say, can I have the same question? Because while you talk about all your hairstyles, I can think about some of mine. So go on, you can knock yourself out.
Well, my mother had this kind of Joan of Arc syndrome thing where she would systematically cut my hair off as soon as it grew any longer than there. And my fringe would be kind of asymmetric when it wasn't even cool. So she would kind of cut it herself and then cut it a bit shorter until I looked like some kind of like Joan of Arc character. And the woman Gloria in the baker's around the corner from our shop, from our house, thought I was a boy, until I actually grew boobs. And then she's like, oh,
it became obvious.
Your son is growing boobs. I'm very happy with it now. I'm actually really happy with everything now. I think turning 40, you kind of come into your skin and you love all your idiosyncrasies.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, nice word. Yeah. So, yeah, I am what I am, and this just grows out the top of my head.
Ron.
Well, you see, I was just smiling then, but actually I was really thinking really hard. I've had the same haircut since I was about 4, I think.
Yeah, you have.
I've never really... I mean, I have obviously had haircuts, but they've always been the same. Apart from one where my girlfriend cut my hair one Christmas. What she'd done was she cut it really short here and left it long here.
That's very so trendy that, now.
So lesbian. That I would have a...
Very lesbian.
Well, he is a lesbian trapped in a man's body, let's be fair.
Sort of, yeah, yeah. Anyway, that was
short
a particularly
hair
bad one.
Wasting my time. Is that Joan of Arc cut you're talking
loved,
about?
I love that. I love that. I love that. I've got cows... telling you everything about me. I've got cow's licks on either side, so it doesn't matter. I grow a fringe, and unless I kind of weld it, it just parts in the middle and looks ridiculous. So it was tough to keep that hairdo, but I loved that. Yeah, it's powerful, isn't it?
Yeah,
powerful.
I loved it. Absolutely. I was like, right, that's it, I'm going for that.
And those boots. I left them on a plane. Oh! I know, devastating. Oh. Costume National, thigh-high leather, soft leather boots. I still think of them fondly.
Shall we dedicate this film to those
my
boots?
My boots. Can I? I'd like to dedicate this film to those boots.
Shall we have a moment? Just have 10 seconds. A silence.
Pimps. Pimps.
Stay if needed. Okay, I'm glad you did that.
Hair today, gone tomorrow.
Just tell us a bit about your grandfather was a composer and your mum was a singer.
I know that sounds very middle class, but actually my grandfather was a blacksmith in the pits, in the mines, but he taught music on the side, so he'd get home and then at 5 o'clock the door would knock and his students would start to come in and there'd be a stream of Valley's kids that would come, to learn piano, and up until he was in his late 80s, he was still teaching for 50 pence for half an hour, And we said, Tide, you could, that's Welsh for grandfather, Tide, you could definitely charge more than this, No, he wouldn't do that because he was letting music be accessible. Music really does give you a ticket out of your situation and a broader view of the world, So... he gifted me with that, and also hundreds and hundreds of other people.
Can you say I love you in Welsh?
Come here, babe. Fi yn caru ti. There you go.
Thank you, I love you too. You lived in a teepee for a while. What was that like? And in the teepee, where did you pee?
Oh, okay. Well, there were a lot of children there. I mean, I moved to the to live outdoors and to live in on festival sites to begin with, and then into communes and traveller sites. It was because I was a very young mum and I wanted to be around other young parents and other parents, maybe a little bit older parents actually, that could give me some guidance on how to bring up a young boy. And it's hilarious because we all should take it in turns to go on the poo walk. So it'd be my turn, grab a shovel, off we'd go, off into the woods to dig several holes and for the kids to have a shit. So when my son went to nursery and when we came back from the mountain and came into civilization again, he's in nursery, I think it was, or just reception class, I said, and he's like, Miss, I want to go to the toilet. Went, that's all right, TV, the toilet's out there, just run. I need a shovel. I know, how sweet is that? I mean, I think that's sweet. Some people might think that's a bit gross, but you'd have to wash their faces, you know, to see which one was yours. It was such a great start to their lives. They were just wild, you know, out in the woods and out in all weathers. And they'd kind of work out who was cooking when. And so they're all fat. Because they're all like, oh, Sad Sack's cooking breakfast, and then Mam is cooking breakfast, and someone else is cooking breakfast. So they'd eat all day long, and it was just a blissful time.
Was it good to write then? Was it good?
Absolutely, yeah, I wrote a lot then, yeah. And that's the main reason I came back off the mountain, because I was singing and writing to my community, but not really taking it any further, and so I had to come down off the mountain to do that.
What's the best gig you've ever played at?
I headlined Glastonbury, and I think it was called the New World stage then, but it was a beautiful, massive stage, the sunset. It probably wasn't a headline, it was just before. But in the front of the audience, which stretched back as far as I could see, with these kids that had deconstructed a cardboard box and painted, Sian, remember us? We're the Breck for kids. And I'm thinking, my God, these beautiful young people now, not just babies anymore, but they were seeing Sian, TP Tits Out, which was my nickname, because I was always adjusting my flaps with with a sarong on, okay? But there's Sian. Sian's doing that. If she can do that, then we can do that. And that, to me, was the most, I guess that was a pivotal moment for me.
It was the Wango Riley stage at Castle Norton. Whoa. This enormous free festival that started off as being maybe 5,000-6,000 people, and as the more and more cars and trucks and ambulances and all that stuff started to converge, it got bigger and bigger, and then it was on the news and the national news, and there were helicopters everywhere. And as the news put it out, more people just kept turning up. They kept saying, there's a big party in Castle Norton. And it's just absolutely swamped with people. It was the most amazing thing. In fact, I can sort of feel myself tingling, thinking about it.
Are you rushing again?
A little bit, yeah. I've got to lay off this tea, it's doing me in.
So, favourite drink and you've got a hangover. What's the fridge filled with?
I like a gin and tonic.
Yeah.
I do. No, I like a gin. I do like Aperol Spritz. If it's that, you know, that you can drink Aperol Spritz any time of the day. You know, if the yardarm's past 12 o'clock, you can drink Aperol Spritz.
It's
okay.
Drink.
It's the Italian they love. Yep. It's Aperol. It's Aperol. It's not a drink. It's Aperol. So it's perfect.
You're an Italian.
I am, yeah. I'm a very cunning linguist.
Ron, what's your favourite drink?
It's seasonal. It's gin and tonic. At the moment, it's that sort of a, you know... But whiskey in the winter, definitely.
Oh, yeah, he's a whiskey man. I love the smell of whiskey on a man's breath.
Nice.
I do.
It is a good smell.
Yeah, cigars, whiskey.
Yeah.
If you smell a whiskey like that, it's not so good. But
on someone's breath, it's really nice. Yeah,
it's
especially alcoholics on the side of the stream. Like, come here, let me smell you.
Oh, gorgeous.
I'm moist.
Super noodles. It's my hangover cure.
There you go. Friend for life.
Super noodles. Honest to God. That you know when you're eating them that it's wrong.
Carbonara, definitely.
Oh, yeah, you make
absolutely
amazing
definitely.
Carbonara.
What makes you scream with laughter, both of you, and what makes you cry?
Do you know what? I love it when I'm not a sporty person, but when I watch people that have dedicated their lives and their bodies to a physical, running a marathon or throwing a javelin or playing rugby. I'm terrible at a rugby match, and I'm a rugby mum. So I'll get upset or get emotional when whoever scores, because it's just an incredible achievement.
I was working on a stage at the, I can't remember what the charity was, but the huge gay men's choir singing Something Inside So Strong with all their little shorts and the rolled down socks.
Oh, babes.
Torture. Absolute torture.
Is that like a happy moment or...?
Yeah, probably. And then, oh, yeah, really, really hard. Don't know why that's so hard.
Oh. I get very, very angry when I see cruelty in any form. Cruelty to animals, cruelty to children, cruelty to women, cruelty to men, cruelty within the workplace, bullying really fucking gets my back up. I was bullied relentlessly as a child and I know how it feels. It's just, you're just so helpless.
As a child that's been bullied, what advice would you give to somebody else in that same sort of situation?
Well, it was the same advice that I gave myself, really, is just keep going, be yourself, because you are the only person that can master that task. No one can touch you if you are who you are. If you stand up and just, okay, walk away from it, walk away from it. Keep telling yourself that it'll be all right, because it will be. Because you will, and, you know, you can't, nobody can touch you when you are yourself, when you are 100% yourself, when you use your voice, when you stand up and be you. You're untouchable.
Yeah, I think that advice goes for almost everything, doesn't it? That's brilliant advice against bullying.
So what's the secret to happiness?
What's the secret to happiness? There's no secret to happiness. It's not a secret. It's open. It's available. Just do it. Just be it.
Help yourself. There's
Help
loads
yourself.
Of it.
Help yourself. It's a buffet.